good morning, everyone. Welcome again to Church Online. We are blessed to gather together again this week. I had this crazy realization this week that this is actually our 11th Sunday that we are online in the midst of this COVID crisis. So that's 11 weeks. Crazy. And yet I'm also so encouraged by our church, you know, our community, all of you. You know, it's a risky time, but God is honoring us as we continue to love God and love people and serve the world. You know, during this time, I've heard a lot of different statements about the church, statements that I agree with and some statements that I don't. But, you know, I've heard things said like we know how to do church in a building, but now we need to learn how to do church in our homes. You know, I've heard statements like I can't wait until the church opens up again. And I'll be honest with you, but this time of quarantine has shown me now more than ever is just how comfortable we had gotten in our Christianity. Like, that's just where we were at. And because we've been saying things like this for years, like as most churches, things like, you know, the church isn't a building, but it's a people. You know, it's not about a Sunday service, but a people who are known for service. So I want to make this really clear as we talk about reopening Yakima Foursquare Church, because the church isn't closed. Yakima Foursquare Church is open and is bringing change into our community. So many of you have influence with those around you, and you're using that for God's glory. The church is open because you are the church. Now, for when we do get to gather together in person again, I'm super excited for that. And we're planning for that. And we're calling it our reemergence plan, because we will have a time that we can reemerge from our homes and we can gather together in person again. And yet it will likely feel different when we do. We will likely see more people meeting in their homes, and we will likely continue to see larger online audiences than we did before this 11 weeks of online services that we're currently in. But let me remind you of what is actually happening right now. And I mentioned this in passing all the way back on Easter Sunday, but I believe it now more than ever that we are in the midst of the COVID revival. Because literally all over the world, people are coming to salvation in Jesus Christ, because guess what? The church is open and the hope of Jesus Christ is alive. If the church was closed, you know, the efforts of Foursquare Disaster Relief or the Water Project or WorldCast Ministries or Compassion International, among so many others who are trying to serve the starving and the in need in our world during this time, it wouldn't be happening, but it is happening. And the hope of Jesus Christ is being poured out because the church is open. So I'm glad that you are watching online with us this morning, and we will continue to do this as long as we need to and even after that. But continue to be the church, because you are Yakima Foursquare Church. Not this building, not this service, you are. Amen? So represent yourself well. Represent this church family well, and represent Jesus well. All right? All right, now, let's get back into this amazing letter that was written to the Hebrews. So this is week 4 of our series called Greater. Now, for the last 3 weeks, the author of Hebrews has focused on the greatness of Jesus and the comparison between Jesus and the heavenly beings or angels, the comparison of Jesus and Moses and the law, the comparison of Jesus and the priesthood and Melchizedek. And let me just say this, the author has proved the point. Jesus is greater. Jesus is greater than any being. He's greater than any person. Jesus is greater than any law or covenant, any priest or any leader. Jesus is greater. And as we enter into this last section of this letter for these next 2 weeks, the author moves away from a comparative narrative that we saw throughout the first 10 chapters and moves into a final encouragement and exhortation to the Hebrew Christians as they live out their faith. Now, let me remind you, the audience of this letter, the Hebrew Christians, were in the midst of the most horrific season of persecution that Christianity has likely ever seen. There's a great movie called Paul, Apostle of Christ, that came out a couple years ago that shows some of these things that these Christians had to face during this time. You know, we talked about the Emperor Nero, right? Who was Hitler-esque in his hatred towards Christians, doing things that were unthinkable. And I won't share those because I know that we have some younger people who are watching with us today. But all in all, the reason it is so important to know about the time that this audience is living in, the time that this letter is being written, is because you can't just put the letter into a modern context and try to live by it. You have to picture the people who are reading it and what they were going through. So this last section of this letter is meant to bring them assurance for their faith. Remember, the easiest way to avoid persecution is by denial of Christ. But how can you deny the Son of God, who by his death and resurrection has opened us up to this direct relationship with our Creator? And this is what the author says, starting in Hebrews 10, verse 19. It says, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus," meaning because of Jesus, we have that access to him and we can be confident in it. And he goes on to say, "Since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water." This is it. He is our high priest. We have been washed clean by his forgiveness. The picture of pure water. I hope that you are all taking showers during this time, maybe not as often as you used to, but picture that feeling of being washed clean. Like, we have that full assurance. And this is the piece of encouragement that the author is giving. It says, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day approaching." Guys, don't lose hope. God is faithful. Encourage people, love people, do good deeds, continue to gather, even if it's online, you know, or FaceTime, continue to gather. These things are all applicable to us in the situation that we're in right now. And the author says, he's saying these things because the day is approaching. And that day is the day of the Lord, so the day that Christ will return. So I want you to understand the mindset of the early Christian. They were all living in expectation that Jesus would be returning at any moment, which is what Jesus challenges us to do, right? Matthew 25, we talked about this just a few weeks ago. They were ready, and guess what? They had to be. See, the mindset of the early Christian is that death was inevitable and it was likely coming soon. So either they would be taken by Jesus when he returns, or they were going to see him soon because Nero would probably take their lives at some point in the near future. So how should you live during this time? How should they live? Well, the author tells them to live upright, to stop sinning. See, Jesus took care of that sin, so you don't have to do it anymore. Who here battles with that, right? Persevere, push through. The author tells them, remember those early days after you had received the light when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were being so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. You've seen this before. Remember, we've been here. Who cares about the earthly things? The next verse says, so do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. What has he promised? Eternity, treasures in heaven, a place with no fear, no death, no tears. Persevere, because if you shrink back, if you give up, if you give in, you'll be destroyed. The author says, we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. And this brings us into chapter 11, where the author focuses us in on the faith that we have. And as the history buff that I am, and as someone who loves the story of our Bibles the way that I do, Hebrews 11 is one of my favorite chapters in our Bibles. Many call it the Hall of Faith, because what the author does is connects the reader's faith to all those characters throughout our Bibles who were known by their faith. So if you're here with us when we were doing the Thread series, you'll remember most of these, but let me take us through it, okay? To start, the question is asked, what is faith? And Hebrews 11, 1 says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Faith is when we are settled in our confidence of who Jesus is and are assured that he will come back for us again. There's one theologian that says that biblical faith is not blind trust in the face of contrary evidence. Not an unknowable leap in the dark. Rather, biblical faith is a confident trust in the eternal God who is all-powerful, infinitely wise, eternally trustworthy. The God who has revealed himself in his word and in the person of Jesus Christ, whose promises have proven true from generation to generation, and who will never leave nor forsake his own. That is faith. And Hebrews 11 brings to remembrance those who have carried that kind of faith. And the author starts at the very beginning. And I want to read this to you because we need to remember as well, because many of us have grown up with these stories. Whether you grew up in the church, you know these stories. And some of you haven't. You need to hear them. But this is what the author says. It says, by faith, we understand the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. This is by faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. You may know that story, but that's Adam and Eve's kids. And Cain killed Abel. It says, by faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, his kids, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, his wife, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, Abraham, and it says as good as dead as he is, which means he was really old, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. And this is the point that the author needed his audience to understand as they were facing their persecution. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, like the promised land, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on the earth. And the author is talking about their earthly promises. Many of them had descendants who received those promises, but that doesn't change the fact that they kept the faith, even though they had died. They were looking for a new land, a promised land. You're not even knowing that God was preparing for them the heavenly land that is in eternity with him. We are all heirs to this. Just as these incredible men and women that we've just read about, just like they're heirs to it, we are heirs with them. The author continues the hall of faith saying, by faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac his son as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promise was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. This was a foreshadow to what God actually did with his son by sending Jesus. Abraham reasoned that God could even raise the dead. And so in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from the dead, even though God saved that moment and he didn't have to sacrifice Isaac. It says, by faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshiped as he leaned on top of his staff. It says, by faith, Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt and gave instructions concerning the burial of his bones. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, he refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God, rather to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the application of the blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. That's the story that you find in the plagues that you can read in Exodus. It says, by faith, they passed through the Red Sea as on dry land, but when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the army had marched around them for 7 days, the story of Joshua. By faith, the prostitute Rahab, who was in Jericho, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell you about Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah and David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. They were There are others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and floggings and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. See, this is something that we have to understand throughout the whole story. From the moment of creation to this time of Christians being persecuted under the reign of Nero, to the global expansion of the gospel through missionaries to the rest of the world, to the COVID revival of 2020, God has had a plan. And his ultimate promise is for all of us. And that ultimate promise is for eternal salvation in the heavenly place that he has prepared for us. You know, next week, Zach Bogar, he's going to be preaching, and he'll talk about the great crowd of witnesses that we see in Hebrews 12. These giants of faith, you know, the Abel, the Enoch, the Noah, the Abraham and Sarah, the Isaac, the Jacob, the Joseph, the Moses, the Rahab, the Gideon, the Barak, the Samson, the Jephthah, the David, the Samuel, and not to mention the New Testament characters, right? Mary, the mother of Jesus, Peter and Paul and John and James. This great crowd of witnesses are subject to the same promise that we are promised with. See, there will be a day that we will be made perfect and we will be walking the streets of heaven alongside all of these who have gone before us. And we can have faith in Jesus for that. I mean, can you imagine being able to walk the streets with someone like Moses or like Mary, the mother of Jesus? Can you even imagine that? It's a faith that we have that leads us to that promise. A faith that is the confidence in what we hope for and an assurance of what we cannot see. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we praise you. God, and I love this story just because you are proving that from the very beginning, faith reigns. Lord, and because you died on the cross for us, by faith we can be saved. By faith in you, we can have that eternal salvation, that we can have that life after death that is perfect with you in heaven. God, we believe in that and we are faithful for that. Lord, and I also recognize, though, that there are people who may be watching online with us, Lord, but people who are our loved ones who aren't walking with you, who are not living by that faith, and it's going to lead to destruction. So, Lord, I pray that you will break through in their lives, Lord Jesus, and that if there's anyone watching today, Lord, that they will make a decision right now to start following you, that they will have faith like all those who have gone before us, Lord, so that they can walk into the promise that you have offered them. Jesus, we love you, Lord, and in your name we pray. Amen. Man, if you want to give your life to Jesus today, it's simply you just telling him. He's right there with you, that you want to follow him, that you want to give your life to him. And connect with us because we want to walk through this life of following Jesus together because we are a family. We are the church. We love you all. Be blessed today. Keep loving God. Keep loving people. Keep serving our community during this time. And hopefully we'll be able to get back together in person very soon. Be blessed.